Do you really ovulate every month? What if your cycles look normal and they seem to be tracking, but you're not really ovulating? What are the signs you should not ignore if you are trying to conceive and you're trying to figure out if you're ovulating or not? Today, we're gonna break down ovulation and anovulation, means not ovulating, and answer all of these questions and more. I'm Dr. Lora Shahine, a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist, helping people figure out if they're ovulating and build their families for over 20 years. If this is your first time finding this channel, welcome. I am so glad that you found this video and me. Be sure and follow so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. I've got so much education here. Go to the playlist, find topics that you're interested in. I'm so glad that you found it. And if you are coming back because you have found a previous video valuable, wow, thank you so much. I'm so glad you're here. There are two other ways to learn and stay in touch. Number one is my weekly newsletter, link in the description below. And the other is my weekly Brave and Curious podcast, interviews, in-depth topic discovery. I love this podcast. You can listen to it anywhere you listen to podcasts, the Brave and Curious podcast. And you can watch video interviews here on the podcast playlist on YouTube. Today, we are talking all about ovulation because you have got to know if you are not ovulating. If you are trying to get pregnant, this is a huge topic to not miss. We're going to go over five main topics in this video. Topic number one, do you ovulate every month and reasons that you might not? Topic number two, why is ovulation so important? And here's a clue, it's not just about fertility. Topic number three, top signs of anovulation that you should not ignore. Topic number four, causes of anovulation. And topic number five, how to confirm that you are ovulating. This is so important. Now stick around to the end of the video. The last topic is going to be tips that you should know when to see a doctor. Topic number one, do you ovulate every month? The answer is probably if you are having regular, predictable menstrual cycles. Now remember the menstrual cycle. It's got two phases, a follicular phase leading up to ovulation in the middle of the cycle. The second phase of the cycle, the luteal phase, is getting ready for the embryo to implant. If it doesn't, you get a period. Now, you really should release an egg or ovulate in order to make progesterone, which is the hormone in the second half of the cycle. And when you are not pregnant, if there's no signal to the ovary from a pregnancy to continue making estrogen and progesterone, those hormone levels drop and you should get a bleed. You should shed the lining of your uterus. That is how people have regular menstrual cycles. So you can have bleeding about once a month and not be ovulating, but in general, if you're having really predictable regular menstrual cycles, more than likely you are ovulating, but you still got to be sure. Now, there are reasons that you might not ovulate every once in a while. Some of these occasional anovulatory cycles are pretty common, and those reasons include stress, travel and jet lag, illness, significant weight changes, both up and down, can affect ovulation, stopping and starting birth control. And the final one is perimenopause, or for those 5 to 10 years leading up to your very last period, which is menopause, you can have a lot of anovulatory cycles. Now, some people can have chronic anovulation where they are just not getting periods. They get periods like every 6 months or every year. Now, that is a real issue when you're trying to conceive, but there's other reasons that it's important that you know this. So there's the occasional anovulatory cycle where you just happen to not ovulate, but then your cycle gets back into its routine. But chronic anovulation or chronic irregular unpredictable cycles, that is something that's important to investigate as well. So topic number two, why is ovulation so important? Well, of course it's important if you're trying to get pregnant. I have lots of videos here on the best days in your cycle to try to conceive, how to know that you're ovulating, understanding the menstrual cycle. Like, I teach a lot about this, and you've got to understand your fertile window is the 6 days leading up to and including ovulation. You actually can't get pregnant every single month of the cycle. And so learning your mid-cycle days, signs of ovulation, like changes in cervical mucus. I've got a great video here all about cervical mucus. Understanding these signs and understanding when you're ovulating is is going to help you get pregnant sooner because you can be more efficient and time trying. Now, ovulation is important outside of fertility, though, as well, because ovulating is meaning that your hormones are working. Everything is communicating. It's a vital sign to have a regular, predictable menstrual cycle. And if you're not ovulating, your ovaries are not making a very important hormone called estrogen. And if you have low levels of estrogen, if you don't have enough estrogen, you can have lots of symptoms. This is why menopause is having a moment. As you get closer and closer to menopause, you are making less and less estrogen, and low estrogen states can lead to headaches, difficulty sleeping, hot flashes, joint pains, so many things, vaginal dryness, pain with intercourse. There's so many things that can show up in our lives with low estrogen, and people can have an ovulation and low estrogen at a very young age. This is not always just a midlife issue. So ovulation is important. Estrogen levels are important, and this is something that you should learn about and understand even when you are not trying to actively conceive. Topic number three, top signs of an ovulation you should not ignore. I can think of six. Let's go through each one. Number one, unpredictable cycle timing. So I've talked about if you're having a monthly menstrual cycle, you are most likely ovulating once a month because you got to ovulate in order to make the hormones that drop that cause a bleed. But there are some times where people just have really irregular cycles and they might not get a period for 2 or 3 months or 6 months. That is a sign of an ovulation. And you can have an off cycle every once in a while. Remember, we were talking about stress or jet lag, weight changes, etc. But if that's happening on a pretty regular basis and you're not having regular, predictable monthly menstrual cycles, that is a big sign that you're not ovulating. Number two, unpredictable cycle bleeding. This is a little bit different. What I mean is most people who are having regular, predictable cycles will say, yeah, I usually bleed this many days and it's heavy for this many days, and like I have a predictable pattern in my bleeding, and it can be different for everyone, but you know your pattern and you should track it and kind of understand your body. And if you are having no pattern, like some months it's really, really, really heavy and you're just like going through products like pads and tampons, and then other months it's like super light, like you might just have like a little bit of spotting and wear like a panty liner, that unpredictability or sort of that shifting can be a sign of an ovulation. Number three, no fertile mid-cycle cervical mucus. I did a whole video on cervical mucus because it is an amazing way to track your cycle and time when you are ovulating and really fertile, because as estrogen levels rise throughout your menstrual cycle and peak around the time of ovulation, estrogen increases the production and changes the consistency of cervical mucus. So when you're really fertile, cervical mucus is going to be producing a lot. It's going to be clear and it's going to be kind of stretchy. You describe it as looking like egg whites. And if you are never seeing fertile cervical mucus, there's a real sign that you might not be ovulating. Number four, no change in basal body temperature. So basal body temperature tracking is a low cost but labor intensive way of tracking your cycle. It can be really helpful, especially in the beginning when you're trying to learn your body. But you basically take your temperature every single day. You got to do it at the same time. And in the morning before you get out of bed, it's like you got to remember it. But what you're tracking is you should have a typical body temperature. And after ovulation, when your ovaries are making progesterone, progesterone makes your basal body temperature go up by about a degree. So if someone is having good communication of their hormones, they're ovulating regularly, you're going to see basal body temperature go up and stay up while your body's making progesterone and then go down again before your next period. So you'll see this, you know, predictable change. If your temperature is just flat, that's a really good sign that you are not ovulating. Sign number five, ovulation predictor kits don't work for you. Now, for some people can be ovulating and ovulation predictor kits just don't work. But if you're consistently having trouble and they just are not turning positive in the middle of your cycle, they are tracking this luteinizing hormone that comes from your pituitary gland to signal the release of the egg from your ovary. And so it should be positive about 24 to 36 hours before you actually release the egg. And so it can be great. People will pee on a stick or they'll track their hormones. And when they see that spike, they're like, wow, that's a great time to have intercourse or try timing sperm exposure, maybe with an IUI, intrauterine insemination, but it's like a way to get a signal before you actually ovulate. And if they are just not working for you, it's not perfect. You might still be ovulating, but it's a warning sign to figure things out. The sixth sign that you might not be ovulating is never getting PMS symptoms. So PMS, premenstrual syndrome, is the symptoms that you can feel right before you get your period. And they come from progesterone, that dominant hormone in the second half of your cycle. And the symptoms can be anything, and you know your body best, but sometimes people talk about, like, of course, cramps or lower back pain, breast tenderness, mood changes, appetite changes, kind of feeling, less energetic. Like, everybody's a little bit different on what their premenstrual symptoms are. But if you don't get those symptoms before you have a bleed on a really consistent basis, there's a chance that you're not ovulating. So your body isn't seeing that progesterone that is showing you that that is an issue. Now, PMS is fascinating to me. And I did this incredible interview with Dr. Sarah Hill, who wrote a book called The Period Brain that explains premenstrual symptoms, explains why we get them even on a sort of evolutionary basis, and then what we can do to make them better. So I really encourage you to listen to episode 148 of the Brave and Curious podcast, that interview with Dr. Sarah Hill. Audio, you can listen anywhere you listen to podcasts, or you can watch the video here on YouTube. I think you'll really enjoy it. Topic number four, common causes of anovulation. I can think of six. Number one, polycystic ovarian syndrome, or PCOS. This is a metabolic condition that can cause anovulation, and it's a very common cause of anovulation. I have a whole playlist on YouTube here talking about PCOS, how to diagnose it, how to treat it, how it can impact fertility. I hope those videos can be very helpful for you. Cause number two, thyroid disorders. Either hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism can definitely affect ovulation. Number three, high prolactin levels. Prolactin is a hormone that comes from your pituitary gland, and it's most used to help with milk letdown when you're nursing or breastfeeding. And so if your pituitary gland happens to be making prolactin, you know, outside of trying to nurse, it can really throw off ovulation. Cause number four, low ovarian reserve, or perimenopause. So there's about 10 years before your last period, which is menopause, where you are perimenopausal, and anovulation is so much more common during that time of life. Estrogen levels are low, ovaries get a little bit less predictable. That can be a cause of anovulation. Number five, hypothalamic causes of anovulation. This means the hypothalamus, which is a part of your brain that kind of helps with this hormonal balance and control, could be not performing as it should. And that can come from stressful events or over-exercising or undernourishing your body. So those are hypothalamic causes of anovulation. And cause number six can be chronic medical conditions. You'll often see it in patients with liver disease, diabetes, chronic medical conditions where the body is really focusing on taking care of the body and trying to heal from that chronic medical condition, and the body shifts away from focusing on reproduction. It's just not going to put energy into ovulation. This is why I tell my patients that their menstrual cycle is a vital sign, and it's important to learn it, to track it, and to understand it. It's a delicate balance between this hormonal communication, and when it's off, it's a sign that something is wrong. Topic number five, how do you know that you're ovulating? Well, I can think of five ways. We've already talked about the first one, just tracking your cycle. So regular, predictable monthly menstrual cycles are a really good sign that you're ovulating. There are four other ways. Number one is a day 21 progesterone level. So it's a blood test for progesterone. You choose day 21 because a lot of people will ovulate around day 14. So you're just kind of giving it a week. And if your progesterone level is over 3 in the second half of your menstrual cycle, that is a sign of ovulation. Another way to tell if you're ovulating is to do ultrasounds in the clinic. You can actually watch the follicle that holds the egg get bigger and bigger and bigger. And when it's about 18 to 20 millimeters in size, it'll then ovulate. And after ovulation, that follicle, that empty follicle, turns into something called a corpus luteum cyst. It's actually making the progesterone that we keep talking about. So you can see signs of ovulation on a pelvic ultrasound. So ways to know that you're ovulating: track your cycle, doing ultrasounds, doing progesterone levels in the luteal phase, at-home basal body temperature tracking, and ovulation predictor kits can be really helpful. I'm glad you stuck around to the end of the video because I want to give you some tips on when to seek help, when you should ask a doctor for help to figure out if you're ovulating or not. I want patients to come see me if they have any questions, of course, but other reasons are if your cycles are consistently less than 21 days or consistently over 35 days, that sounds like an ovulation issue. Again, every once in a while you can have an off cycle, but if it's consistently off, that's something to track. If you are not getting periods for 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, absolutely get an evaluation and figure out why. If you're trying to track and you're not getting positive ovulation predictor kits, you're not seeing changes in your basal body temperature, again, your periods are irregular, if you are worried that you're not ovulating, see a doctor, get testing, and get your questions answered. I hope this video was valuable for you. Like this video if you learned something. Comment with questions that you have. Please follow along, subscribe so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And until next week, stay brave and curious.